So my mama named me Patricia Catherine McCabe. And I feel like I'm in the right part of the world to have this name for once. Because I travel a lot and it's always like, what? So here I am. And my mother actually named me after St. Patrick, which kind of doesn't really add up in many ways, given my understanding of St. Patrick and his work in this part of the world. But and she also named me after her elder sister, Catherine, and who really did a lot to help out their family through some really vast transitions, which we may or may not get into this evening. And then McCabe, there's a couple stories about McCabe. So my father, when my father and mother sit in the room and someone asks, you know, how did you get that last name, McCabe? Because they're both full-blood Diné people. He says, well, when the missionaries came and they kidnapped the children to take them to the boarding schools, they couldn't pronounce our names. And so they just gave us names. Because our naming system didn't work first, middle, last. It wasn't like that. And then he'll get up and leave the room. And then my mom will say, no, his grandmother was sleeping with the priest. So I don't really know. But I'm from the Diné people. And we're from the Four Corners area of the Southwest. So that's Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, Colorado, for anybody who's keeping track of that sort of thing. and our home is within the four sacred mountains. And so I'd like to also introduce myself the way that we introduce ourselves. So Tachi ni nishli aro ashi I bashishchin ma'idish gejne dasha nale klauschi dasha che akwat ao stani nishli. So you're doing much better than the seven-year-olds I talked to this afternoon. They burst into laughter at that. They were like, seriously? So, but what I'm telling you is I'm telling you the name of my clans, and we get our clans from our mother. So the ologists call us a matrilineal society, and I'm not really sure about that. But I do know that we get our clans through our mother, and we get and all of the wealth is passed down from mother to daughter and through the women's side of the family. So that's land, property. So the joke, which may or may not be funny to some, is that the Diné divorce is putting the man's saddle out on the front porch. He gets the horse and the saddle. And, you know, and originally I was thinking, wow, that's pretty extreme, you know? But I thought about it, and I thought, well, so he always has the opportunity to go home to a sister, to an aunt, to a mother, because they're caretaking the home, the land, and they're going to make sure that everybody gets taken care of. So that's a little bit about our system. Now, the other thing I want to tell you, just to really mix it up here, is that I was adopted into the Lakota spiritual practice. So Lakota is an entirely different tribe from South Dakota, North Dakota. And I had the honor of being adopted into that spiritual pathway, which I've been following for the last 22 years. And so in that way, I was given the name Weyakpa Najin Win. Weyakpa Najin Win. And Weyakpa Najin Win means woman stand shining. So, you know, our names, what I love about this naming, is that it really gets to have your whole community take a look at you and see your gift and see some very beautiful, powerful experience that has happened to you in your life. And it's recognized by your entire community. Now, your name can actually evolve over time. So it could be that in another decade or some other place down the road, I might end up having another name based upon another event. But they're very living. But I just love the way that it really acknowledges that every single member of our community has a very special place and that special things happen to every single member of our community. So that's a beautiful system that I really am very honored to be a part of. So I actually want to start this evening by setting up a little space here. So this is, this shawl is from the Lakota way of my life. all this turquoise is more from my Diné way. So turquoise is a medicine for us that helps keep us in a good way, protection, and et cetera. My moccasins are also Diné. Is that pretty straight? Yeah? Okay. Thanks. I know she was watching. Okay. I'm gonna move this up a little bit closer to you all in the front. You're fine. Just because I can tell I'm going to be needing to pace around a bit this evening. This is my bundle. This is what is most precious to me. This is what guides my life. This is what helps me understand who I am, where I am, and how it is. And so I'm placing this here as a way of saying to you that, to the very best of my ability, I will not lead you astray. And that what I'm speaking of here is accessing something that is beyond me. This blanket belonged to my firstborn baby. He's now 27. So on this little blanket here, I placed a few things. That's life. That's life. And I'm also going to light a little fireplace here. So these are things that I like to place out here before I begin this talk, because I'd like to talk about the many, many things that we have in common. So before I light this fire, I want to acknowledge that every single one of us in here, our ancestors had to have a profound relationship with this fire, or you wouldn't be sitting here today, and I wouldn't be here today. So because they had this profound relationship with fire, we all get to move forward and ponder the many questions that we're pondering here today. But this is something that we all share in common, is this connection to the fire. And I want to tell you a little story about this fire also. I had the beautiful privilege of traveling to Ecuador. And actually last week, Drew Dillinger was here, and I was on this trip with Drew. So it's kind of interesting that we almost crossed paths here again, but I guess we will at Findhorn. But on this trip, I had the opportunity to meet the Ashuar people. The Ashuar people are a rainforest people, and they're very beautiful, and they're very powerful people, actually. In their homeland, there's petroleum companies who are looking to devour that rainforest as soon as they possibly can for excavation and exploration. And so even though these petroleum companies have had leases, legal leases on these lands, for over 10 years now, they've been able to hold them off. That's power. That's power. Okay. So the Ashuar people invited me to do a ceremony with them. And it was a great honor, even though I have my own ways from my own part of the world. Because I was in their home and I was doing it with the people and we were on the banks of the Amazon, I chose to accept their offer. And so that night, when we were in the middle of this ceremony, I saw this place in the jungle. And this place looked like our people's, the Diné people's ceremony house. We have an octagonal home. And so I went to the door and I walked in. And when I walked in, there were elders sitting all the way around the inside of this hogan. And they were all sitting with their backs to the wall. And I saw one that looked like an elder from my people, because he was wearing these hats that we adopted, which are these black round felt hats with the very flat brim. And then they often wear some silver or so around the brim. So I saw this hat and I thought, wow, this guy looks like a grandpa from my people. So I went over to go stand by him, you know, and he's leaning with his back up against the wall, and they were giant. They were 10, 12 feet tall. So when I went to go over to put my hand on his knee, you know, I could just set it on his knee, like right here. He was big. And so I saw him looking across the way, and there was a fireplace in the middle of this house. And he was looking across the way at this woman who was very luminous. She was a grandmother. And he looked at her, and he gave her this little nod. And she looked back at him, and she gave him a little nod. And I understood him to say to her, "This is our granddaughter. She belongs to us. But I'm going to send her over to you for your instruction and care this evening. But take good care of her, because she belongs to us." And then I understood that this luminous grandmother that was sitting across the way was actually the elder of the ceremony that I was going to participate in that night. And so that's when I realized that I was standing in the ceremony house of the world, and all of the elders that preside over all the different ceremonies all over the world were all sitting in one house. And they were all looking to the center. They were all looking to the fire. And so I saw that they have great respect and great care with their fireplace. And so as I light this fire for our evening here, this evening, I'm acknowledging their fireplace, and I'm asking that their fireplace be connected to our fireplace, and that anything that they would have us know, anything that they would have us carry with us from this evening and from our coming together, that be made so. So in honor of our ancestors, I always say I at least like to use a wooden match. I know over at Embercom they were talking about making the fire with the bow and the stick and all of that activity. It's a great thing to be able to do that, to be able to make fire in that way. Or some of our ancestors maybe carried a coal, so there was the fire tender that way, right? And so I always like to at least use a match. And I say that, you know, I have my little machine that can make fire like that, right? Just. But I had read a book one time, and it was talking about machines. It was talking about technology, and it said that the machine takes out the tenderest part of feeling. The tenderest part of feeling. So I'm acknowledging that relationship that we all share. So back to this water. Oh, one other thing I want to say about this fireplace. What I've been told about this fireplace is that there is no greater school. There's never going to be a school higher than this fireplace. No university's ever going to touch this fireplace, or what one can come to know coming together in community and participating in ceremonies, participating in communal intention in front of this fire. This fire responds to this. And so also want to speak about this one right here. So this water, I said, this water is life. In Lakota, we say, Miniwa chozane wakam. Miniwa chozane wakam, which means holy water of life. So this is the one that binds all living things together as family. So sometimes we call it the life's blood. We could also call it the life's milk, actually. So what I've come to find out is that this water is just like this fire. It has so many qualities about it that I will never get to understand fully what it is. Even if science can tell me that it's H2O, it's still not really going to be able to tell me what this water is. So this water is not only life, but this water is alive. And I know in some places, Japanese scientist Dr. Emoto's work has been questioned, but his work began to point to trying to explore what is this water really. So for those of you who don't know, Dr. Emoto's work was putting a word on bottles of water, and then he had a method of freezing them and observing the ice crystals, right? And so his work was saying that, you know, when you put words like love and world peace, then they would form these beautiful and light-filled crystals. And when you put I hate you, and I think there was even one I saw the other day, someone sent me this after the last talk at Embercom, you know, I hate you and I'm going to kill you. And I was like, my gosh. Anyway, when you look at the crystal from that, it's cloudy, it's yellow, it's deformed, meaning it's not geometric, okay? So that work was beginning to have science point to what many peoples all over the world have already decided, that this water has consciousness, it's listening. So I had this really amazing thing come up in my life and in my home. And that is that I have a spring coming up in my backyard. So I live it's not a huge town. I don't know that I said, I actually live in Taos, New Mexico, but but it's a fair-sized urban place. I live in a place that has a pretty small backyard, small front yard, and here comes this spring. And so I've been having to really have relationship with this water, because it's coming up about 25 feet from my house. At one point, I was pumping it out with an electric pump, and it was coming out faster than 8 gallons a minute. So, I mean, this water is coming up. So this water and I have been learning how to have a relationship. And I can talk a little bit more about that maybe. But for now, let us just say that this water has been giving me lesson by lesson. So one of the things that this water asked me to do was to go out and take this drive, this circular drive in my part of the world. And on part of that drive, there's a huge lake that extends very long. Like, so I can stand on one end of it and I can see the shores, but I can't see the far end, which in New Mexico is kind of a big deal, being a very desert place, even in the mountains. So I'm standing in the water and I'm singing these songs with the drum, right? And when I get done, the water actually speaks to me. And the water says to me, granddaughter, it's good. It's good that you're singing over the water. The vibration of the song on the water is very powerful. The water has a special way of amplifying your song, amplifying your intent, amplifying your prayer. Even if you just consider physically what happens with water. So you're singing your intent, your prayer into this water, and then the water is going to evaporate and become clouds. And these clouds can travel anywhere they want to, all over the earth, right? So maybe this cloud is going to now travel over to the Andes, where you've prayed, and those elder mountains over there, they're going to recognize you, and they're going to say, hey, our granddaughter is praying right now. Or maybe that cloud is going to travel all the way over to the Himalayas, where I received a very profound healing. There's some people here who have been talking tonight about Ladakh. But in Ladakh, I received a very profound healing from those mountains. So maybe this cloud's going to travel over there and snow down on those mountains, and they're going to remember me, and they're going to be happy. So that intent, that prayer, that act of benevolence and generosity is going to rain down on the mountains. And then it's going to travel down the mountains into little rivulets. And then it's going to come down into streams. And the streams are going to become rivers. And the rivers are going to head to the ocean. So that intent is going to travel. And all of our relatives that we are joined together with by this holy water of life, by this Mani Wachozane Wakan, they're going to have a drink of that water too. So it's going to become a part of them. So we can know that the eagles have drank from this water. And we can know that the buffalo has drank from this water. And we can know that the jaguar has drank from this water and the condor. And we can know that the platypus has drank from this water, this very water right here. So they were trying to talk to me about the way that that water spreads. Now, science says that matter is neither created nor destroyed. Well, it's definitely true of the water. There's not new water coming from somewhere else here right now. This is the same water. It's always been the same water. So from our perspective, this water with consciousness, this water that can listen, this is something else that we all share. All of our ancestors, of everyone in this room, have all drank from this water, this very water. And so all the ceremonies of all the peoples from all over the world throughout time, because the water is always present. Why is the fire always present? Why is the water always present? For these reasons. All their ceremonies, all of their prayers, all of their culminations of all their wisdom and all of their best is sitting in this water right here. So this is very powerful that this is what the water is. And so what I like to say is that, you know, this is what we're drinking. This is what we're standing in the shower. This is what we wash our hands in. This is what we clean things up with. So it's a mysterious entity. It's a mysterious being. And I don't think that I will ever come to know everything that there is to know about this water. But it's just starting to teach me. So I wanted to share that with you. And again, I wanted to bring this commonality into this place that joins all of us together. So what we are doing and what we are saying here tonight is going to join in that lineage with this water here. And that's why I ask that it be placed here, including your intent and what's going on for you as I speak. So where to enter this tapestry? Well, one thing is I always like people to know who's speaking. You really should know a little bit about who's speaking to you. So I gave you a little bit about my family history. One thing that I would like you to know is that my parents and my grandparents were taken into the Dutch Christian Reform missionary boarding schools when they were young. And so what that means for me is that by the time I came along, nobody was speaking our language, and nobody was enacting our ceremonies. Not none of my people, but just nobody in my immediate family, okay? And so this left me in a interesting place in this world. I look like this. And so naturally, everywhere I go, people say, you're Native American, so tell us about yourself. Tell us about who your people are. Tell us about your language. Tell us about, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And that was a difficult thing. That was a hard feeling, okay? Because I didn't know what to say. Sometimes I would actually make it up. But that was always suspect. And so I kind of tried to avoid that. So I would try to, like, fit in, right? And then at the same time, when I would go home to where my relatives were, so my grandmother, when the missionaries came, she was the only child that was home. So they took her, but her siblings were away. So they didn't take her siblings to school. So her siblings remained very traditional people. Okay, so from time to time, I would go with my grandmother to visit her sister, who was a very traditional Diné woman. And they didn't know what to make of me. I didn't know how to act. I didn't know how to move around their fireplace. I was kind of a Martian to them, okay? And so eventually, when we would go to visit, they would just kind of sit me in the corner with a thermos of milk and crackers and just be like, okay, you just stay over there, and we're going to do this Diné thing over here. And that was very painful, very, very painful for me. And so I made a decision when I was very young that I really wasn't that interested in meeting my own people. So that didn't help matters. What I didn't know was that that's just what these people, that's how they knew how to deal with what was happening. But there were a lot of other Diné people who would have had a very different response to me. They would have been very interested in helping me understand who I was and to integrate. Okay, but so that was something that I sort of did to myself by taking on this attitude. You know, I was very young, but nevertheless, I chose to take on that attitude. So that's part of my background. Okay, now that led to some very difficult things. So let me back up a little bit here. So I was started out in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and then my father got a Ford Foundation fellowship to go to Stanford University, a very prestigious university in the United States. And so we went to go live there. And on that campus, we lived in the married student housing, and on one side of me, there were people from Japan, and on the other side of me, there were people from Israel. And the classroom that I went into, more than half of the class was from out of the United States. So it was a very international community. And so after school every day, we'd go running around, we'd go right into this house, it was all about the Philippines, all the smells, all the decoration, all the dress. And then we'd leave that house and run into the next house, and it was all about Sweden, you know? I mean, it was like, it was pretty extraordinary place to be a young person. Okay, so from here, I moved back, and for the first time, onto the Navajo reservation. And so this was my first time to really spend with my own people. And then from there, my parents were very worried about this, and so they...
I'm really sorry to interrupt, but it's incredibly hot here, and I'm sort of going to sleep. I wonder if we can open some more windows and just get...
That's fine with me. Sorry. Thank you for saying. No, that's fine with me. It's a lot of bodies in here. Thank you. So the next place that I went to was the Navajo reservation to live for my first time. And then my parents got worried about that, and so they then next sent me to this very prestigious boarding school on the East Coast, Phillips Exeter Academy, which is kind of the irony about being around here to see Exeter down the road, but. And so that was also like the Kennedys can't even bribe their way into Phillips Exeter Academy. It's very, very. And then from there, I tried to get away from that because it was a huge culture shock. And I went to France and spent some time living in France. And then from there, I just decided to bag all of that whole thing and went all the way back to New Mexico. So all of that had taken place by the time I was 16 years old. So what I get today about that, the way that I interpret that, is that there was a very, very intricate plan for my life and my purpose. And it had to be navigated in this very windy way. But it was the perfect training. It was the perfect education for the work that I'm now doing. But it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy. So at a certain point in my life, I came to this place. I also was raised in the Dutch Christian Reformed Church. And I decided that as soon as I got sent away to boarding school when no one was watching, that I wasn't going to go to church anymore. And that was the end of my relationship with anything to do with spirit or something greater than humanity could come up with. So I went along for a lot of years like that, but the pressure was building. There was still this place of no place to be. Can't go back home and can't go out in the world totally either. And So I began a pretty deep path of self-destruction. And at a certain point, though, I had married and I had kids, and it finally hit me that I was really doing a good job of this. It wasn't really a conscious thought, but now that I look back on it, that's what I was doing. And so I didn't want my children to have to face that. That a lot of self-destruction went on in my family, really as a result of attempted genocide. So I finally sent out this call, and it was pretty lame, pretty half-baked to say, I don't think there's anything out there, but if there was, and I'm sure there's not, I could really use some kind of help now. And what ended up coming back to me was this Lakota spiritual path. These people came to me and they asked me to participate in a sweat lodge ceremony, and I had never participated in a native ceremony. So even though it wasn't from my peoples, it was from another people's way, I decided that I would try it out. And I found home there. I found a home in that place. I healed. I was such a raw, raw, hurting being at that time. And to be able to crawl into this dark little canvas-covered dome on the earth and have them bring in hot stones and close the door and just let me be with the earth and let me be with whatever it was that came in there. I needed something physical. I needed something beyond this brain. My brain was pretty much of a torment to me at that time, even though it had been honed, you know, to some degree. So that's what I needed at that time. And after 2 years of kind of thrashing around and screaming in this lodge and carrying on, these poor people, but they put up with it. I started to have some other sense of myself and why I was here. Now, the interesting thing about this sweat lodge was these were non-native people. Non-native people brought me in. So one thing that you may not know about the Lakota spiritual pathway is that, okay, let's back up. So in United States history, Native people were not allowed to practice their spiritual way. So for me to touch this drum, like even 1940s, 1950s, I could be thrown in jail. And I was talking to an elder not too long ago who was telling the story about how, you know, he remembers his father being in that circumstance and being taken under arrest, all of his hair cut off, thrown in jail, and then they weren't given food or water for several days. So that was sort of the climate, right, in the United States for Native people. So he, his grandfather decided that it was time for them to make a stand. And so they brought out their ceremony out into broad daylight, so to speak, okay, meaning that they weren't going to hide it. And so they brought it out, but this elder man had this vision that when they brought it out, that the four races of man would end up coming to this way. So black, red, yellow, white was how he saw it. And so when he brought it out along with this vision. And I can say that I myself, since I've been participating in that way for about 22 years, have spent a lot of time praying with people from all different races and from all over the world. And in fact, that's been part of my travel, is actually giving women's teaching about this Lakota spiritual way to people in Belgium. I was in Belgium not too long ago, and down in South America and other ways. So it's a kind of an interesting piece. Now, not all Lakota people are happy about this. Not all Lakota people agree with it, but this is how it has come out. And There was this one elder who went to this world interfaith meeting, and he said that the priests were teasing him and saying that they could take a few lessons from the Lakota on converting, because it's a religion that's been spreading and spreading and spreading. So that's interesting. So my point here tonight is not to do any converting. So don't worry. Again, you can breathe a sigh of relief, but I just want to let you know a little bit about where I'm coming from. Okay, so Are we finally getting to the topic? So I think I'm going to back up to an experience that I had at the Bioneers Conference. Has anybody here heard of the Bioneers Conference in the United States? It's a pretty large gathering. It's in its 25th anniversary year this year, of people, thinkers, activists, environmentalists, scientists. Bill McKibben is a big part of that community. Lynn Twist, I don't know, lots of different people. And so I was at this gathering and a couple years ago, and this man named Paul Hawken, perhaps you know Paul Hawken, gave the closing address. And he said something that just rocked me. In his closing address, he said, "If everything continues the way it's going, everything has to die." And this room full of 3,000 people fell silent. It was like he was naming something that nobody wanted to consider saying. Now, that's not to say that I totally agree with that, but it sure was a shocking statement, huh? And then what he said was, and all of the major influences, he's talking about financial, corporate, etc., that are enacting on the world right now, all of them depend upon this death in order to keep going. So I really pondered this. Now, when I was in Ecuador, I had this experience. Everybody that went on this trip had this experience of we were put out into the jungle to do these 15-minute solos. And so to sit out in the jungle for 15 minutes is a big deal. I can tell you that right now. There's like these giant spiders spinning webs, and bats are flying into them, and vines are growing before your eyes, and things are decaying, and things are growing. And I'm always like trying to keep an eye out for jaguars. And you can't see very far in the jungle, right? So I'm sitting in the jungle, and as I do everywhere I go, I ask this Mother Earth, is there anything you want to tell me? Is there anything that I need to know, that I need to bring out, maybe that I'm going to speak to you here tonight, or, you know, is there anything like that? And so I ask, and I don't hear anything. So I'm kind of sitting there watching butterflies and et cetera, and then I ask again, you know, so Mom, is there anything that you want to tell me? And I still don't hear anything, right? And so I know my time is getting close to being up 15 minutes, and I just can't believe she doesn't have anything to say to me. So I ask her again, you know, Mom, anything at all? You know, is there what would you say to me from this place? And she said, "Life." And that rocked me equally. And in the jungle, you know, you can't deny it. You can't deny it. And I tell the story about how I had left a deerskin pouch similar to this bag, much smaller, to make offerings over there. And on one particular day of this journey, I decided to leave it back in my, it was like a yurt on stilts kind of thing out in the water. And very nice. Very, very large cockroaches, though. Flying ones, but still very nice. Anyway, I left my pouch in there for the day when we went off somewhere, and when I came back, it was eaten. There was just a few laces, a little bit of the bag left, and the little ants were finishing carrying it off. It's a fierce place. It's a fierce place where you cannot deny life. Life, right? But what I realized also is that no matter where you go, that's really the story. Like, so even I live in the desert, and part of our ritual is to put ourselves, or well, our community puts us out onto a hill, and we don't eat or drink for a period of time, sometimes up to 4 days, and it's crying for a vision, okay? But you'll lay down on your side there, and you'll start watching the dirt, you'll start watching these little plants, even in the desert, and it's just teeming with things going on, right? So I'm thinking about what Paul Hawken had to say. If everything continues the way it's going, everything has to die. And then I'm thinking about what the earth had to say. So I'm like, And, you know, and what I came to was this, is that, you know, all around us, everything, case in point, is doing one thing. It's doing one thing. It's making more life. It's making more life. And so even, you know, I might listen, hello. Even out here, it's teeming with life, I can tell you. So there might be a tree on this side of the building, right? Or people. But there might be a tree on this side of the building, and the earth is informing this tree how to be here. Okay, here's what we're gonna do, because you're over here, you know? And there might be another tree, exact same species, maybe in the exact same age, and you'll notice that it's growing a little bit differently. Okay, well, you know, and the earth is informing that tree. Okay, now here's what we're gonna do, because you're getting all this runoff and, you know, et cetera. So there's a different strategy, but everything is being informed by this earth about how to be here and how to make more life. And what's so beautiful about this life making going on is that it's all about efficiency, right? So it's about efficiency. So, but the beautiful thing about the efficiency is it's not about a straight line between point A and point B. If you really watch, that's not always it. So apparently efficiency has other components. Efficiency has other components besides speed and direct. My father always used to joke, he'd always say, why do people always say as the crow flies? You know, have you ever seen a crow fly? They're busy, they like to do rolls and, you know. One time I was in the snow in Taos and I actually watched these, they might have been ravens, but I watched them and they were actually taking turns making snow angels for each other. I am not kidding. One would be on its back and the other one would be watching, and then it would hop up and they'd both look, and then the other one would get on its back, and I watched this for a little while. So this is efficiency for life making for crows. And I love it. It's beautiful. Okay. So here's the thing. It's all about life. It's all about life. It's all about life. That is the game plan here. So why does Paul Hawken say this? What has happened? What has happened? Now, I don't know if everybody in this room looks at it this way, but many people would say that it has something to do with the five-fingered ones. I had a woman in Belgium say, I don't like it when you say that because I was born with six. So, I apologize. That's what our elders call us, the five-fingered ones. So our name for ourselves is Diné, meaning the people, but our full name for ourselves, and really it's referring to the human beings, is we are holy earth surface walkers. That's us. We're holy earth surface walkers. So what's happened to this holy earth surface walkers? It seemed to me that we had forgotten a most basic part of the plan. The plan is life. The plan is life. So when I realized that, that's when I finally decided, you know what? I got something to say out here in the world. I'm going to get off my bench. I'm going to get out of my shy, although my education definitely kind of took a lot of that away. I have a persona. I have an academic persona that can and debate. And but my actual self, my presence, sorry, I keep knocking this, is pretty shy, actually. But I decided that, you know, I can get past that, and I got something I want to say. Because there's things I've been taught through these ways. There's things I've been taught through these ways. And that's all this buildup has been leading to this part. But you got to know why. You got to know why the feminine principle, the feminine design, and the masculine design matters. Okay, so the Lakota people talk about the hoop of life. And that's a way of talking about an interdependent, interrelated flora and fauna. So everybody's got their place on the hoop of life. Some peoples can even go so far as to tell you what degree, you know, at 1 degree it's the owls, at 2 degrees it's the otters. I mean, they've got this down, right? They understand the relationships. And so so we, the five-fingered ones, have one spot on this hoop of life, but it's not the whole thing. We have one spot. But here's the thing about the hoop of life. Anybody doesn't uphold their part of the hoop begins to lose its integrity to be a hoop. So when we don't uphold our part, things begin to fall on this hoop of life, which I believe is what we're seeing right now. Okay, so everything on this hoop of life is designed for this grand scheme, the grand scheme of life. Everything is designed for thriving life. That's my belief. Because if you leave everything alone out there to do its thing, it does this amazing thriving life thing. And author Barry Lopez talks about the impeccable nature of all of our relatives out there. They go about this life in an impeccable way. And they do. So I have to believe that we also, the five-fingered ones, are also designed for thriving life. So this leads me to my scientific inquiry. My scientific inquiry is, what is my design for thriving life? And how am I working against my design for thriving life? Because right now I have to believe that somehow we are working against our design for thriving life. So that's what I go around with all day long. Is this part of my true design? Is this not part of my true design or my inherent design for thriving life? So I'm trying to really pay attention to that. Okay, so here's the place where I'm going to say this next piece. Okay, so I think we're getting that we're kind of off on our thriving life, and so now there's this huge rush looking for the science of sustainability. Sustainability. I call it thriving life. So we're looking for our place in that again. So here's one thing that I have said for a lot of years. If sustainability is the highest and most sought after technology on the planet, who should we be talking to? We should be talking to those peoples who lived in one place over an extended period of time, say 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 3,000 years, with relative health, harmony, and happiness. And we tend to call those people indigenous. That's why I'm speaking. I really want to make it clear. This is not about ethnocentricity. This is not about saying, you know, rah, rah, I'm Diné. It's so cool. And it is very cool to be Diné, I will say. But that's not really the purpose. So I really want to make it clear. I'm really not that interested in being a show and tell. I'm very interested in this business about thriving life. And so I'm coming here to speak to because I have that experience of being one raised Protestant, and two, raised in very high academics. Now, I have been holding back saying this part of my talk so far, but I'm going to let it fly right now. So there's a man who wrote this book called Native Science. So there was this Institute of American Indian Arts in the United States, and because they wanted to have accreditation, they had to have certain curriculum in place. So all the students said, okay, we'll have science in our curriculum, but why do we have to have like Western science? Why can't we have our own science? We have science. And you know, when I think about that, when this man was talking about why he wrote this book, we have science, it makes me think about how, so I travel a lot to Central America, South America, right? And so there's all this rainforest jungle, and I was describing the ferocity of it, right? So there's people who will want to build like a cabin or a little hostel or something down there, and they'll build it, they'll clear away jungle, they'll build it there, and then they leave for however long. Well, you can guess what I'm going to say, but when they come back, and it has just been devoured, right? Because that's the nature of it. And yet there are ruins in those jungles that are thousands of years old that have been left, and they are not devoured. Why? So Western science is starting to get this idea that maybe these indigenous people are not just lucky. There's a science going on there. There's a science going on there. So I've had the just fascinating and also heartbreaking at times opportunity to be in dialogue between Western scientists, the very highest tier of Western scientists, Nobel Prize laureates in physics, NASA, and indigenous people. And there were these dialogues that started out in Canada. Actually, it was quantum physicist as well. Quantum physicist David Bohm and Leroy Little Bear of the Blackfoot Nation, they started these dialogues together. And they ran for about 13 years. And I was a part of them for about 5 years. And they were amazing, fascinating discussions. So, so there's a science going on. Now, in this book, Native Science, that I read, there was this one part that really struck me. And it was this part that said, now, why is it that when all the ologists came over and had a look at us, they wrote things about us like we were childlike and we were primitive and et cetera, right? So I don't know if he was angry about this or not. He didn't show this in this writing. And to me, this is the mark of a true elder. A true elder does not create separation. To me, a true elder does not create separation. So instead, he went into inquiry, and he said, now why would they say this? So he started to look at who these men were. And what he realized was, one, they were men. Two, they were tended to be aristocratic men from Europe and primarily from England. Okay, so these were the people who had the means and the interest and et cetera to do that kind of travel and do this kind of work, right? So they were the ones who came over. So he said, all right, well, let's take a look at their culture and what they're doing. And what he wrote in this was, he said, all right, so what I'm observing about these men from Europe is that they are allowed up to a certain point in their life, 5 years old, to sing, to dance, to pretend, to play. And then at 5 years old, especially for the aristocrat, right, it's time to get down to the serious business of being a man. And so you can have hobbies, but the primary business of being a man is to develop yourself in one way of knowing. That one way of knowing is through the intellect. So, when these men came over to have a look at us, what were we doing? We were singing, we were dancing, we were visioning, we were pretending. And so, of course, that was their point of reference for those kinds of activities. Those are the activities of children. And even the grown men are participating in this. So this, they must be a very primitive culture. Because this is all we have, right, is to come out of our own experience and look across the fence and then try to make sense out of it. Fortunately, there's a whole lot of work going on right now about cross-cultural interaction, and that's a good thing. But this really struck me, you know? This struck me so deeply. Because what it made me realize is that, so here are these people that we call indigenous people, and they have this ability to be in place, connected to place, for 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 3,000 years, and develop these incredible science. You know, they know about constellations in the sky that the Hubble telescope is only just now finding. How do they know that? They know all these different things, you know. And so what I started to think about is maybe a part of that is because their upbringing is to bring in this very wide spectrum of ways of knowing. And they go about that from the time that they're little all the way through their entire life. None of those ways of knowing are shut down. So in my mind, I'm starting to equate having a broad spectrum of ways of knowing with sustainability. Okay, so let's get back to our design for thriving life. Thank you. So we may be working against our design for thriving life if you buy my premise that we're actually our design for thriving life, and somehow that plan isn't going very well for us. So there's a lot of different places to have inquiry, right? So one of the places to have inquiry is, that I've chosen, is what do we do with our feminine aspect? So that's feminine meaning, you know, a lot of people and cultures also say that, you know, we have a masculine and feminine aspect inside each one of us. Then we have the masculine aspect of the embodied male of our species, the embodied feminine of our species. So what are we doing about gender, you know, what, and in particular, what are we doing about the feminine? So in the Lakota spiritual way of life, again, I'm not looking to convert anybody, but I want to use it as a point of reference for possibility. In the Lakota spiritual practice, a woman on her moon time, meaning that at the time when she's menstruating, she's not allowed to be where the sun ceremonies are. And I personally think that some piece of their traditional way got stamped out somewhere. I'm suspecting it might have been when the church came into contact. Because in that way, when the baby girl is born, we honor her. When she has her first moon time, we honor her. When she gets pregnant, we honor her. When she has her baby, we honor her. When she becomes a grandmother, we honor her. But I've witnessed and been a part of, you know, let her go on her moon time when a sun ceremony is coming on, and they're just like, shoo, get, you know, we got to leave right now. And they're screaming and hollering. It's pretty wild, and it's pretty difficult. It can be. It's not at every place, but in many places it has been this way. And so what I came to find out about that time, so again, I was raised up in this way, and from the very beginning, I always was given a place to pray when I was on my moon time. So we would put down a ring of cedar, and they would put blankets and pillows into this ring of cedar, and they would put the women on their moon time in there. And let's say I was in my little ring of cedar over here, and maybe in that corner of the room there would be the sweat lodge, so it wasn't even that far away. So that ring of cedar was to kind of keep my energy in and keep us separate. And so I could wave to the people who were going into the lodge, and I felt very included. But later, I came to realize that that wasn't the case everywhere I went, that there was actually a pretty big pretty big issue. And in many places, rather than be given a place to pray, I was just told, get out. And that felt pretty violent, actually. So, but this was the custom. But as I got further into that practice, what I came to find out was that there was one man who, for his community, he was a chief, he asked 7 women to go and fast for 4 days without food and water for 4 years. And their primary inquiry was to ask, what do we do with the women who are on their moon time during our ceremonies? Now, to me, this is genius. I mean, I love this man. This is great. Because he really wants to have a sound answer for this that's outside of superstition, outside of, you know, because clearly it was conflicted. Some people said always this, some people said never that. And it was very conflicted. So what these women came back with was, when a woman is on her moon time, she's moving in a different way. So in the sun ceremonies, we're praying from our heart, up and out, right? That's the movement. When a woman is on her moon time, she's going inward, and she's going downward. Energetically and literally, she's flowing downward. Okay, so those two motions are opposite. The other thing that they came back with was a woman on her moon time is moving counter sunwise. That's her natural movement. A woman and everybody else is moving sunwise, okay? So those two things are also opposite. But the main reason why you wouldn't want to have a woman on her moon time in these ceremonies is that she, in her body, holds a gateway. And that gateway is the gateway between heaven and earth. It's the place where life comes from. And so, otherwise known as the cervix. So when that gateway is open, the woman is drawing in from all around her. She's drawing in all kinds of energy, all kinds of power, all kinds of medicine, you could say. But the difficulty is, so here we are, some of us are in the sun ceremony, we're praying up and out, we're asking for what we need, we're asking for power in our lives, we're asking for healing miracles, which I've witnessed time and again, and that power will come, that power will come. But if the woman on her moon is there, then all of that goes to her. Okay? So, so there's a correct place for her to be. And that is kind of in her own space. And what she has the capacity to do is actually draw up this information from the earth. So she's drawing up the nurturing, the nourishment, the creativity, the understanding about how to be here. Just like the trees I was talking about, just like all this other life around us is getting information from this earth all the time. So through Lakota perspective, this is a woman's capacity. Now, what they said that used to happen was all the women would sleep with their heads to the center of the teepee, the lodge. Sometimes they'd call it a dream lodge. And they would have communal dreams. And these dreams would be used to inform the community of different things, where to hunt, different ceremonies that needed to be enacted. Because here's the thing about people in place. People who have known how to live over an extended period of time in place, they've got relationship. They've got relationship to that place on the earth, to what's growing there, to rainfall, to sun, to excuse me, to everything. And part of the way they have that relationship is by keeping this broad spectrum of ways of knowing open. Part of the way they do that is through the ceremonies. So for a woman to be able to bring ceremonies to the community, that's going to change and deepen and adapt their relationship to place. So these women would bring this back, and this was a very integral part of community. This was an integral part of our system of knowing how to be here. I want to tell you some Moon Lodge stories, but I think I won't right here, right now. I'll tell you one. So I was in this one place, and it was the first time I had been put in a large community Moon Lodge, meaning, so there was this place that was fenced off way over there where nobody could see us or anything. And at first I was pretty outraged that that was going on, that we were fenced in somewhere. We were in our little Moon Time prison way over there. And I was very offended by it. But over the days, I began to witness some things that I never knew before. One, I got to witness how when women are all put together that way and for intentional purpose, they all begin to move in synchrony. So we were falling asleep at the same time, we were waking up at the same time. At one point, we actually all got sick to our stomach at the same time. And that we were right by the front gate of this land where all this ceremony takes place, and there was somebody watching the gate to, you know, there's always someone there making sure who's going in and out. And so they ran and talked to this chief, the same one who asked these women to do the vision quests. And when he heard that that's what had happened, he had everybody on the land, because everybody was kind of gritching a little bit at each other, and he had everybody on the land go into the sweat lodge so they could purify and come back to center. So he was using that information. That was the one time I really witnessed that in a community like that. What I also witnessed was there was this cooler in the middle of the place where we were, and we didn't know what was in it. We thought it belonged, each of us thought it belonged to the other one. And so finally we realized it didn't belong to anybody that was in there. So we open up the cooler, and inside of it is sodas and chocolate. We said, oh, this must be for us, you know? And some of us chose to eat some of that, and some of us didn't. But what I can tell you about that, as soon as we ate that sugar, all of that synchronicity stopped on a dime. Gone. And I said, wow, that explains a lot about this world. That explains a lot about this world. The other thing that I noticed that would happen is, you know, the first night that we were in there, we were all feeling very, 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 very separated from the rest of what was going on outside. And so we were asking lots of questions about, well, who came on the land? Who's going to go out for their ceremony? You know, what's going on out there? We wanted to know all about it. And so they brought us dinner and they would tell us all about it. So they would bring us our food. And they would bring us our food because they said, we want you to be comfortable and we want you to dream. Pretty good stuff. Pretty good stuff. So the next morning, they came in to bring our breakfast, and they came in and they were chatting and talking, and we had shifted to a whole different place. And so this time when they came in, we were like, whoa, you guys, that's too much. You need to just stay at the gate. These were other women, okay? You guys need to just stay at the gate, and you can leave the food at the gate and just holler over and we'll come and get it. So we had shifted. Now the rule at this place was that a woman had to not show any sign of her moon time for 24 hours. And so the other thing I got to witness is when a woman came off of her moon and she was waiting for that 24 hours. So those of us on our moon are all on this side of the teepee, all piled up like puppy dogs, you know, asleep. Because you get very dreamy in that place when you really acknowledge that intention. On the other side is this other poor woman who's waiting to leave, and she's just pacing like a tiger, just really wants to get out of there. It's actually kind of painful when you're in that place. So I just got to watch the energetics of what happened in there. So I guess what I want to say is this is speaking to me about the spiritual and even the scientific, and it's in that broad sense that we're describing here, a capacity of the woman in relation to her biology. In relation to her biology. Now, one point that I often bring up is, you know, what happens when women all live together? they all start cycling at the same time. I don't know if you guys knew that, but that happens. So I used to work at different places, and all the women who all worked together, we'd all start cycling at the same time. Now that's speaking to some kind of design. That's biology. And this is one thing that I'm starting to really get, is that our biology is points to our design oftentimes. I mean, we're probably mutating to some degree, but we're still not that fast. So that's one place that I really look to for my thriving life design, and especially with this ceremonial experience. I would really love to talk to you a lot more about that, but actually that's more what my workshop goes into, is a lot more about these things. But I want to give you an example out of indigenous culture about the kind of thing that I'm speaking of. So let's think about what happens in this, I don't even know what to call it. I used to call it American culture, I've called it mainstream culture, I've called it Western culture, I don't even know what it is. At this point, it's all over the world. My good friend Barry Lopez, once again, he says, you know, it's the MTV TV culture that's spreading like cultural nerve gas. But whatever that culture is, that is now in most parts of the world, what it tells the woman is, we don't want to know about that. We want you to plug it up, shut up, and carry on as though nothing is happening. Carry on as though nothing is happening. This is from our perspective, from our culture's perspective, and I could talk about it from Diné's perspective, this is one of the most powerful aspects of a woman's design. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about the other end of the spectrum. So now I'm in a place where I'm no longer having moon time. It's been about 2 years for me. So when that started happening, I got really angry. I was really grateful that I had the chance to really understand who I was and what my capacity was having my moon time before that happened. I'm grateful. But what made me angry was I kept being told, and I kept watching it and feeling it for myself, my husband had left me right about that time, was that at this age, the woman becomes invisible in this culture that's spreading around the world. The elder woman becomes invisible because everything, all media, all songs, everything is all focused on that young woman, the young woman. Now, I went into the sweat lodge and I just pitched a fit, just screaming, crying, cursing at God, etc., kind of fit, which I hadn't done for years. And I had some brothers that were in that lodge and they were holding that space for me to do that. And when I got out, I heard from my spiritual guidance that, hey, you know what? Just relax. We didn't bring you this far to drop you on your head, okay? So just try to relax. And no, just keep following this continuum out of the Moon Lodge way, because we're gonna keep going with it. We're gonna keep going with it. And so, what happened was, I was having so many symptoms. I was having like this freight train running through my nervous system. Bad, okay? And just this mental fog that was like, whew, totally, totally, totally. You know, I used to watch my aunties when I was a little girl, and I thought, these ladies are really dippy, you know? Now I understand what was going on. So I had this mental fog coming on. I would be so tired, but I'd lay down to sleep, and it was like I had drank 10 cups of coffee. It was a hard way to be in the body, okay? And so I had a brother of mine who was going to do some healing work on me. And when he was doing that healing work on me, I finally got some kind of download about it all. And what I was told was, you are in labor again. You are in labor again. And the symptoms were like that. There were days when I could just, all I could do was just breathe, just shallow breathing to just stay on top of it. Okay? You are in labor again, and this time you are going to birth yourself. So it's necessarily going to be this big event. They put it to me this way. They said, so you know werewolves? Okay, so werewolves, when they transform, like they've got all this hair coming out, they've got their bones stretching, they got this sinew popping, they're like, it's on that scale, okay? And they said, and you know the butterfly? You know, I mean the caterpillar, before it becomes the butterfly, the caterpillar goes into the cocoon and becomes liquid and doesn't know if it's ever going to be an anything ever again. They said, so this is on that scale. But if you will stay with the process, you will be able to claim a seat in the grandmother's lodge. This process can be circumvented. So just in the same way that we tell the young women, we don't want to hear about it, just pretend it's not happening every month. And in fact, at this point now, I want to back up here and say, I know there's a lot of reasons that women make a lot of choices. It's a very high pressure situation to be a woman at this time. So I honor all of that. I honor all of it. But I'm going to say that this is what they said. They said, so, you know, for the young women, we'll say, you can even take a pill and you never have to have a moon. Convenience. Some of it's medical reasons and all other kinds of reasons, but some of it's just flat out convenience, right? And then on this end, they'll tell you the same thing. If you just take pills and have a boob job, you're good to go, you know? You don't have to put up with all this. So here's, again, the woman at her most powerful, being circumvented systematically. Because what they told me about that time is they said, now you are coming into being the fruitful woman. You are coming into being the fruitful woman. So we think of the woman, the childbearing age woman, as being the fruitful woman. But that's only one aspect of the fruitfulness. So whether you've had children or not, this time of the life is meant to be the fruitful woman, where you can use all of that experience. And imagine, if you will, for a minute, if you have sat in Moon Lodge every month from the time you start having your moon all the way up until this time of life, and you're being informed and instructed and being given the creativity and wisdom and nurturing and nourishment from this Mother Earth every single month, by the time you hit Grandma, woo, you're a force to be reckoned with. This is the possibility, right? So I'm doing my best, I say as I'm like, to not circumvent that process. Now, when I first started speaking, I still was having my moon time, and what I was finding was that so often, every time I was gonna speak in front of a large group of people, I would go on my moon, even if it wasn't time for me to go on my moon. And I'd be like, ah. Because that's like the last time that you really want to stand up in front of a group of people and project and be extroverted. But what I realized is that this world really needs to hear from the woman in that place. We don't hear from her. And the same is true of me right now. So I've been having some pretty deep symptoms again. They come and they go since I was heading out this way. And it's not always that easy, but what I've been told is the world really needs to hear from the woman in this place. She cannot become invisible. This is one of our collective, beautiful pieces of understanding of our design for thriving life is the woman in her complete journey, the woman in her complete journey to elderhood. Now, the grandmother's lodge is the counterpart to the men's leadership in some cultures. So I had the great experience of talking with Jake Edwards, Chief Jake Edwards of Onondaga Nation between New York and Canada, right? That's where his people are. And he was talking about how the grandmother's council would choose the men's leadership, because they've known us since we were little boys, he said. They know our natures. They know what we're suited for. And so they put us into the leadership positions, and they can take us out. He said, but they rarely do. Because they're elders, okay? This isn't junior high. They're elders. And so he said, but they rarely do because they would rather teach us. They would rather teach us. So this is one example, and not all indigenous cultures hold this, but this is an example of that grandmother lodge being that counterpart to men's leadership. So this little fantasy I have is, what would it be like if the grandmother's lodge chose the president of the United States? We'd all have a lot less to worry about all the way around the world. I can tell you that for sure. So this is pursuing one line of thought, one line of thought. Now, I'm sure my time is really crazy. But I want to get to the masculine aspect, because you guys have sat through this whole talk about moon time, and thank you. I know that's not always a subject for everybody. I was always taught to give the moon time teachings for men and women, because it doesn't do us really good to only have the women understand what's going on. So when I was having my meltdown and my angry fit about becoming this elder woman, I sat in our people, the Diné people's ceremony house, the Hogan, and I started asking, so what does this mean? This, you know, what are we really talking about when we say masculine? What do we really mean when we say feminine? Like, what happens if we drop those words? Because those words are so loaded at this point. So what does that really mean? And I heard this response. It was the first time I really heard the response from my own people's way, so it was very exciting for me. But I heard this, oh, okay, now you're on to something. That's a very good question. Because your view of masculine and your view of feminine right now is very, very mutated. So what you understand as masculine and what you understand as feminine is only understanding what those are given the structure, the paradigm that you're choosing to be in. And they talked about this power over paradigm. So as my daughter says, from the time we're five, we're taught to compete. I wish you could see this little beautiful girl here. How old is she?
Nearly five.
Yeah. 5 years old. Taught to compete? So it's the power over, you know? The structure is there's first place, there's second place, then there's, you know, third place. So you're always wanting to be that guy that's on the top. There's one seat at the top, and that's where you're trying to aim for. You got to be that. Right? And this is part of the difficulty with science. The intellectual only science is also this competitive component is skewing so much truth that could ever even be found that way. So they told me, and the power over paradigm, might makes right. And in that paradigm, that means that, you know, back in the days when it first started, that it was going to be the men who were going to hold those seats on the top for being physically more powerful. Today, we might say that the might makes right is more in terms of economics. But even there, so the men are still going to hold those seats. There's this glass ceiling that we talk about, which is changing somewhat, but it's still there. So in this predominant paradigm that is quickly spreading everywhere, well, I don't know how quickly, but it's definitely spreading everywhere and is everywhere in most places at this point. There's this structure, right? So they're saying to me, so masculine for you is what happens when you take a human being and you stuff them into this paradigm. That's what you're calling masculine. And feminine is also for you what you get when you stuff the woman into this paradigm. That's not what our nature is. So that is not who men are. So for my people, there's a womanhood ceremony, which I would love to tell you about, but I won't right now for time. But there's a men's ceremony. And what I love about the men's young men's ceremony is that there's a few things that are asked of the men. Men are to know how to build a house with their own hands. Men are to know how to make a bow and an arrow. Men are to know a basic herbology. They're to be able to provide some amount of doctoring for their family. So these are the kinds of things that I'm looking at about men's culture in a culture that I would call that had been and in many ways still is sustainable. But what I want to say to the men here this evening is, one is, I don't know if you had realized that this was the feminine design and sustainability before you came in. But nevertheless, I really thank you for coming here this evening. And what I want to say to you is that the deeper that I go into what I believe is my design, and I have the benefit of having two different sustainable cultures informing me about that design, the deeper I go into that, one, the less I'm concerned about your half of the equation. Not about you, but about trying to keep up with you in this strange situation that's going on. And the more I turn my attention to the business at hand of what my capacity is by my design as I understand it, the more I have an appreciation for you. And that has not always been the case. Because before, so for me, the highest that I can give to you is I can pray for you. I pray for Men's Nation, okay? But I haven't been able to pray for Men's Nation because trying to empower you, wanting you to be powerful, was like cutting my own throat in this paradigm, in this terrible paradigm that is a choice. It's a choice that we have been collectively choosing, right? So I have not been able to do that. Now, I'm designed to have the love of a mother, whether I ever have children or not. I believe that I'm designed to have that love of a mother. And so I'm here to benefit. You know, I'm the one who's going to hold the land, the sheep, the horses, everything, so that everybody gets fed. That's supposed to be my nature and my heart. That's what my people tell me. So for me to begrudge you who you are, that's definitely going against my design. Definitely. So I want to say here that I apologize to you for that. I didn't know. And now that I'm starting to know who I am, what I can say to you is that I need you. I need you. I need you. When I'm attending fully to the business of being a woman, I'm extraordinarily vulnerable. Extraordinarily vulnerable. And so one of the things that we talk about culturally is that the man is protector and provider. And that's, I need that. When I'm doing my work over here, I need that on your side. I know that there is much, much that you are beyond that. But I want to bring it back to that. The other thing I want to say to you is that, you know, I make prayers all the time now for men to be just as powerful as you can possibly be. Physically, I need your physical strength. I don't have it right now. I need your mental ability, that way about you that used to drive me nuts. That singular focus thing. I don't have that, and I'm not supposed to have that right now. I'm supposed to be seeing and feeling in a very different way, but it's a part of how you live in physical world. That's a part of it, and you got it. And maybe you have that, you know, the multitasking way as well, but I know you got that. And I just want to tell you that I appreciate it. And I need that. Emotionally, there is nothing more powerful than a man speaking his heart. And the deeper that I move into my heart and into this territory of interpreting and bringing forth the heart of this Mother Earth, I need you to be in that heart, to meet me there, to meet me in that place for what I'm bringing. Spiritually, I know that we are equals. And I pray for your strength spiritually. So it's really important for me to be able to say this. So to me, this is a piece of my inquiry that I really feel led to share with you. And any place that I have a chance to bring it, if you'll let me, this is what I want to say to you, because I believe we were designed for thriving life. So what I hope is that when we turn towards our design instead of against our design, things are actually going to ease up. I think it's actually got to be a little easier to float with the current than to fight tooth and nail against our own design. We're already feeling the struggle. We're feeling the pain. We're watching that destruction, that dependence upon death. So when Paul Hawken gave his talk, you know, if everything continues the way it's going, everything has to die. That was pretty grim, right? But there's a flip side to it that I love. There's a flip side to it. And that flip side is, that means that anything anybody does that is for life makes you a revolutionary on behalf of our species. Yeah. Yes. That's good news. That somehow simplifies things, right? There's plenty of work to go around. We don't have to fight over it. But that's what that means, literally, at this point. Anything that anybody does that is for life makes you a revolutionary on behalf of our species. So the field's wide open there. I want to end by saying that, you know, I had a relative that I went to for a healing session, and she she started working on me, and then she got partway in, and she goes, "There's nothing wrong with you." And I just had to laugh, you know, because she had come to my part of the world, and I just hadn't seen a Diné healer there for a long time, so I was kind of going for a tune-up, I guess. She goes, so I thought, well, that's a great checkup. But she said, what you have to remember is this: you were born into beauty as beauty for joyful life. You were born into beauty as beauty for joyful life. That's the truth. That's the truth. So that's a big part of what I incorporate into my design. And so when I'm not feeling that, I have to believe for me that I am swimming against my design. So anyway, thank you so much for your very kind attention.